Hi, welcome to the Scrum Engineering Chronicles. This is part two of the hauling rack build. This time around, we're going to be finishing the assembly and doing some dry fitting and also getting some paint onto the rack itself and covering any last minute cleanup. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments. And if you haven't seen part one, I'll put a link down in the description so you can watch that first. If the video seems a little bit long, you'll have to excuse me. I'm still getting the hang of this, but I also don't want to skip pertinent details. That's why they make the little slider bar down there. Just grab that and shove it over to the right side, and you'll be good. So with no further ado, let's get going. Right, so here is the paint I picked up. This was a gallon for, I think, $16. Flaw and Utility oil-based glossy enamel. That's what I'm going to be painting the hauling rack with. I just got done sanding it with my new rigid belt sander. I'm actually pretty happy with that. That seems to be doing pretty well, and it's lightweight. It's very lightweight. But now I'm just mixing the paint and trying not to slop it everywhere. And then I'm going to go put on a first coat on the uprights and then haul out the other pieces and get a first coat on those. And then I'm probably going to have to knock off. It's getting dark. It's supposed to rain before too much longer. And it's cold. Let me go ahead and do that with the daylight I have left. And I'll cut. Well, that's my luck. I just got everything set up, propped up on some newspaper. And I just started applying the first coat. I was working my way down, and you'll see that little bit right there. That's water. It started to rain. Wasn't supposed to rain for a while, but I guess God made up his mind early. Didn't consult the weather service. Yeah, so I just got done pulling everything in. For now, I am thwarted, and I am sad. Because it's lovely cold weather. It cooled back off here. Looks like we get one more week of cool weather before it goes berserk. So, nothing for it. I'll try to find some other things to work on. Hey, everybody. Boy, the garage is full of fumes. This is a quick status update. I've got the first coat of paint on all of these different members. I've got the long ones balanced here across a piece of equipment. This one actually has two coats on it. Two coats of this floor paint is really starting to make a good slick surface. I'm hoping it stays durable with that end grain. Really still sucks it up though. I'm gonna need to touch those up again. These only have about one coat on them, so they're gonna need another coat. And I would be doing it right now, except it's a blustery day and it's starting to sprinkle, and that kind of sucks because it means my progress is held up. Here you can see a little sneak preview of some pieces that are coming in the project. After this, I painted those too, but these are only part of the next project. I've got to clear off the bench and, oh God, what a mess, and make a little bit more progress on a couple of side projects. Yeah, that's where things are at. So I'll do what I can. I've got to, God, I've got to get some of this cleaned up because my God, I can't move in here. This is driving me insane. Absolutely, absolutely insane. So more as it comes. I am not gonna wait on the weather. I am using a very, very cheap chip brush. It's normally used like in machine shops because you can get these, a box of them for, I don't know, $6 or $7 at Harbor Freight. And they work perfectly well for rough paint projects like this where your finish is not critical. You just need a way to apply the paint. It's even cheaper than the packs of foam brushes. But again, I really don't care. I'm not looking for a fine finish on this. My interest is purely in protecting and sealing the wood and getting a thick, hard coat of paint on this. So go ahead and set this. Nothing to do but dry. Just step and repeat with the other three. So we'll go from there. Okay, the weather cooperated and I was able to throw the doors up so I don't die of fume inhalation. And I painted all of the cross members on both sides, and you can see the little blocks down in there holding them up. So those will be dry by tomorrow. I was able to take the uprights out and just barely touching against the plastic garbage container. Those are painted front, back, top, bottom. They're upside down right now because I wanted to make sure I got the bottoms coated well. I got a lot of thick coat of paint on, and I actually went back, so there's three coats on these now on almost all of the area, all the areas. But those are basically done. I'm just waiting on them to dry. Right, so now comes the actual hard part of putting the rack together and finishing the last few pieces, the cross pieces. Now, these are 1-inch galvanized, I don't know if you can see that, galvanized pipe. You can get this in various lengths at your home center. I had cut two pieces based on the overall dimensions of my rack. These are about 5 feet long, thereabouts. So they extend past each of the vertical uprights, about 2 to 3 inches on each side. The trick is these come in pretty long lengths, this galvanized water pipe or gas pipe. And cutting them can be a real pain. So this is the point where all the elbow grease comes in with a hacksaw. Now, I used a metal grinding wheel cutoff saw, which you can see up here, because I had one. That made pretty short work of it and is a better solution. So if you can borrow one of these, do so. It'll save your arm. It'll probably save you 20 minutes worth of hacksaw work. Thing to bear in mind is your rack may not be perfectly square, and the reason for that could actually be your truck. In my case, the rear of the bed of the truck is splayed outward slightly, compared to the front of the truck. So there's, you know, about 3/4 of an inch difference. Now, whether that's with age or by design, I don't really know. But there is a slight difference. As a result, you're going to have less overlap on mine on the rear. You know, you might have this much sticking out past the edge of the stand. In the front, you might have, you know, twice as
And if
much.
your lumber
isn't perfectly square and everything's not perfectly aligned, which it isn't, we didn't do a super precise measuring job on all of it. Yeah, things are going to be off a little bit. So don't cut your piping until the last possible step. Once you got the measurements and you know what to do, just cut them to length. And then the other thing you're going to need to do is get a single piece of 1 1/4 inch PVC pipe. And as a result, you can see the diameter difference here. And it kind of sits and rattles around on this galvanized water pipe. Once you've got it cut to length, then the next step, and really kind of the second to last step in the process, is putting in something that will keep the PVC from rattling around. Now, on my original rack, I had drilled these holes, and I just had some I went and got some stainless steel bolts with a washer, lock washer, and a stainless steel nut, and I used those drilled through. And that gave me a fair amount of slop, right, for this. On the new rack, the design is slightly different, and so I don't want these bolts where they're at currently. They're chafing on some of the wood, so I need to move them in a bit. So there's my new mark. I'm actually moving it on both ends. Yeah, that one. So I'm actually going to move the bolt down, and I'm just going to drill those new mounting holes for these. I picked stainless steel because I don't want this stuff corroding. Two dissimilar metals, you're asking for disaster. So stainless is the way to go. But that's it. Project's in the home stretch. So let me get drilling and get this done. I really need to make a V-block for this, but this'll do. My new hole. This is just a little warning for any of you guys who get in a hurry and don't want to use your safety equipment, okay? When I was drilling that pipe, this is the kind of stuff I'm getting, right? It would grab at certain points and spin off these curly cues. And you can't tell this, but I can. These things are razor sharp on the edge, these little spirals. And once they start spiraling off, they begin whipping around and whipping around on the drill bit and start throwing pieces. You get one of those in your eye, those little slivers, it might be game over, Charlie. It's certainly not going to feel good, I'll tell you that much. Norm Abram was right. Wear your safety glasses. Just, you've been warned. Got my new hole drilled. So let me go ahead and put one of them in. And again, someday I'll clean my bench, but not today. You can see this. I know I'm backlit, which is a no-no, but that's one put on. Just slap on your length to your C-pipe. That keeps it from sliding around. Here's the old one. Here's the new one. You can see it's going to give me a lot less play, and it moves the bolt down a bit, so I shouldn't have the chafing problem where it was rubbing in the groove on the vertical upright. So then that gives me what I need. Now, all I gotta do is drill the two new holes in the other pipe. Ta-da! That's it. The only other thing I've got to add are the there's some keeper pieces that I talked about. I got to bolt those on. I got to get some bolt or wood screws to mount those. But even as it sits, these can't come out now. So I got to take a measurement off of each side and sort of split the difference, as it were, and then I'll custom fold the metal to hold those with just a little bit of slop. But this thing is complete, and the beauty of it is with these rollers, and this is why I designed it this way originally, way back when with the first version of it, one person can load and unload, and I'll show you that at the end. Whether it's a long ladder or a canoe, one person can carry a rather large canoe, but it's almost impossible for one person to get a canoe balanced across the tailgate and then with a blanket on top of the cab of the truck, or with the tailgate down, and it's a mess. With this thing, and just a roller right forward. The modification, moving those bolt heads in, made things a lot better. The only other thing I'm going to do is got myself a king size Sharpie, big one. I'm gonna label these, you know, right side, left side, top, rear, top, front, and so on. And here's a quick boo-boo that I made when I was banging around and prying on it. I ended up splitting it, but that's an easy fix. I'll just drill and shoot in a long wood screw after this glue is cured. Hi, so the camera is holding for right now. If it flakes out and goes all purpley, I apologize. I'll be getting a new camera, but I wanted to try to shoot the rest of these videos and get this all wrapped up. Let's see what we've got here right now. I just finished making some more fixes to the support legs, and here is, you might be able to see or maybe not, there is the split where this actually split from me twisting and prying on it and trying to pull it apart. The glue dried. I beat on this. It's not moving now. The glue joint is actually probably stronger than the original wood. Given that this is kind of a weak grain situation, I went ahead and after gluing it, I drilled and sank in a 3-inch drywall screw, and I've done that on both ends. Then I took the other members of this that have the same kind of possibility for weak grain cracking, and I drilled and countersunk and put in a 3-inch drywall screw to hopefully give some extra support there and keep those from cracking. The only tricky part, this one is labeled as front bottom. Well, let me put it up here. It's basically like this. So rather than drill from the top side where I could get a pool of water and rust and so on, I drilled from the underside. That's what I did with all of the members, those 2x4 members that I've reinforced. I drilled from what constitutes the underside when it sits assembled in the truck. So I would recommend that putting a long decking screw or a wood screw in there to reinforce this, just to avoid that problem. Hey everybody, we are ready for the last step. If you look over here, the last piece I need to make is kind of a keeper clip that fits on like this. So what I've come up with in my scrounging, because that's what I do, I've decided I'm going to cut them from this. What is this? Well, as you can see, it's one of those restaurant / catering drink service things. This one apparently was for iced tea. Why am I using this? Well, for one thing, it was free. Free is always good. We like free. The second reason, and really the more important one, is it is stainless steel. Being that this is food service, it's required to be stainless steel, right? So it's never going to corrode. And you could make the keepers, the little C-shaped keepers on this, out of anything. I mean, you could, I've got some OSB scrap. I could have, you know, come in here and cut a rectangular piece of OSB and, you know, screwed it in on either side and then screwed in another little chunk of 2x4 in there. There's a bunch of ways you can do it. It didn't appeal to me to do it that way. There's nothing wrong with doing it that way. On the first hauling rack that I had built for my truck, I had something similar. I just had some wood blocks. But I happened to find this in one of my dumpster dives recently. So as kind of an experiment, I thought I'd try cutting those C-channels out of this stuff. I still have to figure out how the length I'm going to need, and then I'll end up cutting it and then kind of pounding it to shape in the vise that I need. Then it'll just be a question of drilling a couple holes on either end of the C shape and mounting it. But I got to cut 4 of these, so let me go ahead and get started. You can see how well we progress. Okay, there we go. Okay. Need a persuader. All right, and that is the first of the keepers installed on the end. All I gotta do is bend and mount the other three. You can make these out of pretty much anything you want. I happen to have that stainless steel. I used it because it's stainless. If you wanna make these out of wood and build a little, you know, add-on widget out of wood, that's fine. If you've got some other sheet metal, an old cookie tin that you want to use, those work great, especially if you can find people throwing stuff out. Old baking tins, that kind of thing. That soft metal is easily bent in a vise, pair of pliers, that kind of thing. So let me finish the other three, and that's the finishing touch. Rack is done, and there is what it is designed originally, the hull. And if you look closely, you can see why I extended it so far above the roof of the truck, because the nose of this thing extends down quite a bit. I didn't want to risk screwing up the roof on my vehicle. And as you saw, it wasn't a big deal to load. Just trundle the canoe on my shoulders, and once I get the nose of it up on there, it's a piece of cake, honestly. Well, that's it. If you've got any questions about the rack, the construction details, or anything else, please leave them in the comments, and I will do my very best to get back to you as soon as I can. I want to thank you for your indulgence. I know my videos are longer than most on YouTube, but I feel that a lot of the instructional and DIY videos on YouTube are too short. That's my personal opinion. If you disagree, let me know in the comments, and let me know why. I honestly prefer the longer format. It's a little more relaxed. I can take my time. It's hard enough doing all the project and then filming, you know, 18 takes and having to try to narrate and keep my wits about me. That concludes the canoe wreck. In case you're wondering, I am indeed hiding under the canoe. I'm hiding under the canoe because it's only middle of April and it's already getting hot here in Houston. Not terribly, terribly thrilled about that. But if you have any questions on the rack, the construction details, any questions about materials or that kind of thing, please feel free to leave them in the comments. I want to thank you for watching. I'd like to thank my subscribers. Thank you, and I appreciate you watching, and I'll ask you to stay tuned because I will be back soon with another scrounge. It's hot out here. You'll have to excuse the noise. There's been construction at a water plant near our house for the last year. I'm not real happy about it. I'm gonna try this one more time. Thank you to my subscribers for watching, even with all the background noise, like the plane that keeps flying overhead. Let's try that again. Really? There's gonna be another jet. How much fucking air traffic can you guys divert over top of my house today? Really? Thanks. I'll just wait. I don't know why I'm wasting your time with all this crap. I don't know that you care. If anyone's out there, click on like. What the hell?